गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
सो गुड
गुड
मॉर्निंग गुड मॉर्निंग। आई थिंक नाउ वी कैन स्टार्ट द डिस्कशन विथ वन ऑफ द क्वेश्चन। एक्चुअली आई हैव रिसीव्ड वन क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम सुनंदा। सी आस्क दैट विजन वाज to have a 100% gross enrollment ratio by 2017 as per the vision of Ramsar. Okay, so she is asking that whether we have achieved that vision or not. Means that goal we have set that by 2017 we will have a 100% enrollment, gross enrollment ratio in the secondary education. And if we have achieved or we have not achieved, so how we will verify? So the first part of your question is that even on paper, because when we talk about the ground reality of implementation of a program, we must see the two aspects. First aspect, what the government is saying on the paper, and the second one is the what is the ground reality. For sake of example, when we talk about the SSA, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, government used to say that we have a 100% enrollment, we have a 100% retention. It means that all the children in the age group of elementary education, they are in the school. Okay, but in fact they are not in the school, even though they may be enrolled, but they are not in the school. If they are in the school, so how we are seeing the children begging across the road and doing the child labors and all those kind of a thing. So it is not there, and it has been revealed by the several report and the several survey of the some agency. Okay, so now come to the Ramsa. Even the government report does not says that all the children in the age group of a secondary education are in the school. How we can verify? In order to verify, you have to refer the several statistics. One statistics you can refer the census report, and through the census report you will see the categorically they have a data related to the population in the different age group. So we just see what is the age group of a secondary school children, and how much population of those children are. Okay, then you will find other statistics that is released by the MHRD related to the enrollment and the enrollment ratio also in the different level of education, like that 1 to 5, 5 to 8, like that. Even the statistics shows every year MHRD used to release statistics in its annual report. It is available in the MHRD website. So you can see that what is the enrollment and what is the population. So you easily you can figure it out that how much children are out of the school in the secondary age of secondary school education. Okay, so by this method we can verify it. Okay, census data, I am not giving here the data, all those things, because the census data is easily available in the census website. Okay, there is a website of the Census of India, so you can go and very beautifully it is arranged that the population from the different parameter. And you can download the annual report of MHRD. You try it, if you will fail then tell me. Another method of verifying is that one website is there of Government of India. That website name is data.gov.in, data.gov.in. Shall I type it or it will be okay to you? I will type. So,
okay.
data.gov.in.
yes, data.gov.in. So here you will find a lots of data from a different sector field, lots of data. Okay, and there is also facility if some data you are searching which is not available there. Okay, you can raise the question, and they used to say that within the days of 15 they will make it available, so you can post the required data. And obviously the data must be from the field which the government used to capture through the several survey or a census or that kind of a thing. If it is beyond the scope, then it will be difficult to get the data, but this is obviously within the scope, so by that also you can get the data. Okay, so these are the thing. Other thing is that that is not very much reliable in the sense that it requires the personal approach. You will know that every district have a national information center, informatics center, NIC. Every district they have a branch. The central office is in Delhi. It is a government of India department, and every state and within the state every district have a branch of that National Informatics Center, NIC. Okay, this is the agency of a government of India which used to handle the data related to the different things. So ideally, if you will approach, they are bound to provide the data ideally, because their duty is that whatever the employee is employed there, their duty is that to provide the data to the different needy person. But you know the government system, it is a very hard to get something. And so if you have a some sort of approach to that office, you can easily get. Or sometime it also depends who are there, who the attitude of the officer. Sometimes they are very good also. So whenever you will approach, you will provide, they will provide the data. So there are varieties of methods of capturing the data. However, this data.gov.in portal is very user friendly. I will request to at least see it once. Okay. So these are the methods of knowing that what is the status of a different thing and the getting the data. Okay, now up to here, when we were discussing the Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, we have seen that what is that RAMSA, how it has been conceptualized and implemented, what are its different features, and vision we have already seen. Now we will come to see its different you can say that the intervention, what are the different kind of intervention is planned within this program. And when we talk about the intervention, basically there are three intervention that has been planned. That one is the intervention related to the quality, another intervention related to the equity, and the third one is the intervention related to providing the infrastructure. Because when we see the conceptualization of this program, we find that this program talks about the quality, equity, and obviously in order to ensure quality, we must have to work on the parameter of the infrastructural parameter. So these three things are the important intervention when we talk about the RAMSA. Sunita, why are you joining so late? You have joined just now, so try to join on time. Okay, that will be better. Whenever we used to talk the infrastructural facility, providing an infrastructural facility, or better to say that in terms of, in words of the Ramsar document, policy level document, the infrastructural intervention. Okay, so what could be the infrastructural intervention? Devyani is also joining now. What could be the infrastructural intervention? Means, in order to have a qualitative education at a secondary level, what kind of a infrastructure is required? Because it will require some sort of a infrastructure. What kind of infrastructure is required? Anybody? Question is that in order to have a quality secondary education, what kind of a infrastructure is required in the school?
सर जैसे कि जो सेकेंडरी में लैब चाहिए होता है
लैब
साइंस स्टूडेंट के लिए
हाँ
लेबोरेटरी चाहिए होता है
लेबोरेटरी भी रिक्वायर अदर
बॉयज गर्ल्स के लिए सैनिटेशन और वो जो डिफरेंटली एबल बच्चों के लिए रैंप वगैरह भी होना चाहिए क्योंकि सेकेंडरी कंप्लीट करने से ही वो आगे जा सकते हैं
ओके रैंप दैट मींस हाँ दैट मींस द डिसेबल्ड फ्रेंडली इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बेटर टू से disable friendly infrastructure. Yes, other than that, Damodar is saying the different Susmita is saying ICT enabled classroom. Damodar is saying different discipline for different lab. I think you have written just reverse, different lab for different discipline. It should be reverse में आपने लिख दिया proper sanitization facility Smita yes then बस उतना ही चाहिए lab for vocational education teacher and student ratio school with accessible distance that was there because it is in the policy document whenever we are talking about the physical infrastructure na it will mean that the facility within the school premises because that policy already says that up to secondary it will be within the radius of a 5 km from the student's residence and for a senior secondary it will be 7 to 10 km that is the policy matter whenever we are talking about the physical facility it will include the facilities infrastructural facility within the school premises good ventilation that is the proper facility for fresh air and light proper library with digital as well adequate number of classroom okay so now we will see one by one so I will start with the proper library and digital as well see whenever we talk about the infrastructural facility within the school premises it talks that there should be a proper physical infrastructure like that the sitting arrangement sufficient number of classroom laboratory library everything even the playground and whatever the classroom or a lab we should have it must be proper ventilated it must have a scope of the coming the natural light and together with that the other facilities which are very much essential from the point of view of quality education, that is the playgrounds, okay, recreational area where the student can be engaged in the creative work. All those things are there. But when we talk about the library, the digitization of a library, that component is not there, digital library, because the digital library requires some other facilities also, which may be beyond the scope of this ministry. However, it is not like that whenever we talk about providing the facility to the classroom, only the Ministry of Human Resource and Development works. Why I am using the earlier term? Because when this policy, that is a program, was conceptualized, that time the MHRD was there. Nowadays, you may replace the MHRD with the Department, Ministry of Education. So, when we talk about the library, even the when we talk about the laboratory, the even there is a concept of a digital laboratory is also there. Okay, and it is a very wonderful thing. I will give you some link where you can experience the digital laboratory also. But within the framework of this program, policy of this program, the digitalization was not much emphasized because it requires some other facility, like the facility of the electricity, which is very mandatory, facility of the internet, it is also mandatory, and facility of the computers, its maintenance, and more important thing is that locally available technician who can maintain the equipments. That is the one of the basic requirement in order to have a digitalized library and a laboratory. Okay, so but it is not all also that only MHRD is working when we think of providing the infrastructural facility in the educational institute. Broadly, I am talking here. It works in collaboration with the other departments and a ministry also. Okay, so when we think of providing the ICT tool, it works with the Department of Information and Technology, like that. They work in the collaboration, even the Ministry of Energy, so that the electricity should be provided, quality electricity should be provided, like that they used to work. But within this framework of this program, policy framework of this program, that component was not there. Here two things are coming, so it is I will like to have a very brief discussion on that. One thing is that I was talking about the digital laboratory. The appropriate word which is used for the digital laboratory is the virtual laboratory, where you can do the experiments virtually. Means actual equipment will be not there, but virtually you can do the experiments. Okay, and nowadays so many institutions have developed, including the IITs, even including the Amrita Viswa Peetham, I think that it is a deemed to be university. So they have developed a virtual laboratory. So like that they have developed. And when you will see, I think several time I was telling that one of the platform developed by NCERT, that NROER, National Repository of Open, Free and Open Educational Resources. So when you will see that platform, you will also find some of the interactive content, which is somehow related to the laboratory of the school education. So you can visit those website and you can see those things. Another thing which I will like to mention it here, that we talk about the for the digitalized content, because in order to have a virtual laboratory, डिजिटल लाइब्रेरी एंड यूजिंग अ स्मार्ट बोर्ड एंड अ स्मार्ट क्लासरूम इन द स्कूल, इट रिक्वायर्स अ डिजिटल कॉन्टेंट. विदाउट हैविंग अ डिजिटल कॉन्टेंट वी कैन नॉट डू ऑल दोज थिंग्स. सो फॉर हैविंग अ डिजिटल कॉन्टेंट वी मस्ट हैव अ क्वालिटी इंटरनेट कनेक्शन. ओके, quality in internet connection, but that is also solved by having a NCERT was in the process of developing that is a server kind of a thing where all the computer will be connected to that server and all the digital material will be in that server and every nodes means every computer can access as and when it is required. And when there is a requirement of upgradation of a digital content, that server will be only upgraded. So the instant need of internet is solved here. So that is also going on. Even the Intel has brought that kind of a product. So just now I am not having the link of that product, but if you give me some time, I can just search over the internet and I can give the link also. 1 minute, just wait, I will give you the. Okay, I'm not getting now, so it will be better. I will give you the link later on. So that are the development in the area of when we think about the using the ICT in the classroom situation. And obviously the one of the major emphasis was providing a basic facility within the classroom, like a blackboard, like a sufficient seating arrangement and sufficient classroom, and the well ventilated classroom so that the student can sit comfortably, the well equipped laboratory so that the student must have a experiential learning opportunity, library for the enrichment of the learning experiences, then art and craft room for the recreational activities and the creative activities, that art and craft room, toilet, that was the one of the big emphasis in the having the universalization of secondary education. Because in the previous discussion also I was discussing, due to the lack of the functional toilets. Why I am using the word functional toilet? Because when you will visit the classroom, and I think during your internship, BEd internship, you must have visited some schools, you must have find that the school have a toilets. But it is not functional, and in you will find that in the most of the government school there is no water to the toilet, so it won't be functional. Or if it is a very dirty, it is not maintained, so it won't be functional. Even it is not a sufficient, means as per the student teacher ratio, what are the number of teachers, what are the number of student, what are the total enrollment of a girl child. So sufficient is not there. Suppose that the 1000 enrollment is there and two toilets are there, one for boys, one for girls. So also we can think that it is not very much functional. So I am talking that functional toilets block is necessary. So because when we talk about the secondary education and children are in the adolescent age, they require some sort of this kind of a facility. And if the facility is not there, obviously they won't come to the classroom, okay, because of their personal need. So Nanda is replying, yes sir, most of the toilet and bathroom are not working, no water supply, no provision of the disposal of waste. Yes, even I have seen that in some of the government institute and the very good government educational institutes, sufficient number of a toilet is there, water is there, everything is there, but proper sanitization is not there. Means the cleaning of the toilet at a regular basis. Regular basis means if there is a 100 and a 200 students are there in a educational institute, it must be cleaned at an interval of a 2 to 3 hours, because the frequency of using is more. Na, we must see the what is the frequency of use. Suppose that we have the toilet in our houses, so what is the frequency of use? It's a very less, so we can clean after 2 days or 1 days or a regular basis. We used to clean on the in an interval of 1 or 2 days, but in the educational institute the students are more, so frequency of use will be more, so it must be cleaned at an interval of 1 hour 2 hours 3 hours, like that. And functional toilets is very much required. Then provision of safe drinking water. So I was talking about the provision of safe drinking water. And because the drinking water is a very much essential kind of a thing, which is very much required. So there must be availability of the safe drinking water. Safe, why I am using that, in the most of the school you will find that they have installed a hand pump, okay, and the students are drinking the water from that hand pump. But depending upon the geographical location of the school, the water may not be very much safe. It may have the other impurity, like that the iron, or when you will go to the some of the area of Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh, even the Orissa, fluoride may be more than the desirable level, which is not treated as a safe drinking water, because it can cause the illness to the child. Okay, so the safe drinking water should be there. In the most of the school I have seen that they have a borewell and a motor installed, and the water goes to the water tank, and there is a some points are installed where the student can take the water from the water tank. But what is the frequency of cleaning the water tank? It is not cleaned frequently, and obviously it will come the matter of the frequency of use. Okay, so it must be cleaned at a proper interval. So the safe drinking water is very much important, and that all those things are emphasized in the policy document. And when you will talk about what is the current position, okay, just like the Sunanda was asking that with what is the status of enrollment ratio, gross enrollment ratio in a secondary education. You just visit 2, 3, 4, 5 school within your locality, you will find that what is the status. And it also talks about the provision of a residential hostel for teacher and a student. And basically it emphasizes the for the teacher, especially in the remote area, because in the remote area facility of staying is not there, and it is also sometimes difficult to come to the school after traveling a long distance on a regular basis. But these are yet to come, it is not there. Okay, so these things were there as a interventional strategy on the part of the infrastructural facility providing in the school. Sunanda is replying, most of the time AquaGuard or Paint are installed but non-functional. Yes, it is non-functional. Even you can see that our department is not having the safe drinking water, proper sanitized toilets. So you can just think of the other thing. It is not a matter of our department. You can see the other department of the university also, even the different educational institutes. Even when I find the RI also, they don't have a very much sanitized toilet. This is my experience. And I have found in the majority of the government institutes. Yes, sometimes it is used by the faculty only. Yes, yes, you are very much true. Okay, so any question up to here? We will take a question break. Any question from anybody? Another person can also talk when I am talking. Okay, so it is a platform to have an interactive kind of a discussion. If you will not ask the question, if you will not ask something, then I will be autocratic instead of democratic. Nothing is there. Nobody. Prakash?
Yes, sir.
Huh. So, any question from you?
No, sir.
Sunita?
No, sir.
Sunita, are you here? Sunita Singh? Are you here?
Yes, sir.
Huh. So, any question?
No, sir.
Okay. And Santosh ji, are you here? Santosh?
Morning, sir.
Ah, good morning.
Yes, sir.
Nowadays, you are not asking question. I am missing your questions.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there is one question in the chat. It is asked by Chinmayi Panda. What is the virtual laboratory? See, it is a very new thing in the field of education. One kind of a laboratory is the real laboratory, where you can have a physical equipment, apparatus set up, and you can manipulate and you can perform the experiments as per your need. But as the word virtual suggests, there will be no physical setup, physical equipment in order to perform the experiments. But everything will be in a virtual mode. Like that, suppose that you must have done, how many of you are from the science background? Achha, those who are there. Okay. So, two examples I will give. One example I will give from the secondary level, one example from the senior secondary level. So, in the senior secondary level, those who have studied science, you must have performed one laboratory activity in a chemistry, that is the titration activity. Titration, have you seen? Oh, pinkish type ka solution aata hai? Pink solution?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Ah.
Yes, sir.
Remembered. So, when we perform the titration in a real laboratory, what we will do, we used to do, we have actually what are the different ingredients, means the different solution we used, that I have forgotten. But we have that, and we used to put from the pipette drop by drop.
Yes, sir. Methyl indicator, sir. Methyl indicator.
Okay, 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 okay. Yes. Thank you for remembering me. So, we used to put drop by drop, and we shake the solution, and we continue putting the solution till the moment it turns to a pink solution. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, this is the, this we used to perform in the physical laboratory. But in the virtual laboratory, what we will do, we in the screen we will have all the solution that are there in the chemistry laboratory of a secondary school. You have to choose, you have to put like a game, you must have seen the game. So you have to put you have to choose and you have to put the solution, everything will be same, but it will be virtually. You have to shake also, you have to put the drop also, like that. Everything you are required to do the same, but it will be virtually. There will be no physical equipment available there. And when
sir,
we
so,
हाँ yes
अमृता विश्वविद्यापीठ में आप जैसे example है वो virtual laboratory वो example है
हाँ they have developed virtual laboratory अमृता विश्वविद्यापीठ okay they have developed that is a very useful and that is used in even some of the schools, even some of the universities, they used to use that platform. Okay, even you will find the some interactive content like that in the NROER also. Okay, NROER, it was developed with the help of HBCSC, Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, which is a part of TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and NCERT. Both have joined hand together and they have developed. It was a Government of India project. And when we talk about the experiment from the secondary school, we will find that suppose that we have to we have to calculate the value of a small g. Okay, so for the value of a small g, we have a bob tied with a thread, and we shake it and we count the time period. Okay, and there is a formula procedure by which we used to calculate the value of a small g. So in the virtual laboratory also, you can have all kind of arrangement, and since the value of g depends upon the geographical location where it is calculated, so you will have also facility of changing the location. Means it has the facility to change the latitude and longitude. So like that the facilities are there. So it is this is setup we used to know as a virtual laboratory. Okay, so this was all about up to that providing the infrastructural facility. So shall we move to the other intervention? The next intervention
yes sir.
The next intervention was but already we have a 4-5 minutes, so some of the things I will complete, and question answer session we will have in the next class. Just beginning of the next class we will have the question answer session. Okay, because in the 4-5 minute it won't be possible to have a question answer as well as the discussion also. So the other intervention strategy was for the quality improvement, because it talks about that the quality equity in the secondary school education. So for improving the quality of the teaching learning process, it talks that there should be a focus on the science, mathematics and English education. Specifically it talks the three things. Why it talks about the mathematics? Because when we see the mathematics and the nature of a mathematics, we know that it is a science which develops the creative and a critical thinking ability. It is a science which works on a precision. When we talk about the nature of mathematics, mathematics is a precise science. Mathematics is an accurate science. It develops the problem solving ability among the learner. Okay, and mathematics, when we talk about the mathematical problem, So mathematical problem can be solved in the variety of way, and there is a systematic procedures of solving a problem also. So it was visualized that by the study of mathematics, student will also develop a precision in their work, accuracy in their work, problem solving ability in their life, because problem solving, when we talk about the mathematics, it is not only confined to the solving a mathematical problem. Rather than it is based upon that by solving the mathematical problem and having a structured framework of solving problem, we will be also able to solve the problem in our real life. For sake of example, we can talk that one of the very famous and widely acceptable framework of solving problem that is given by George Polya. I think at some point I have discussed in the classroom also. George Polya has written one book, that is How to Solve It. Its name, the name of book is How to Solve It, wherein he talks about there is a four step of a solving a problem, and the problem is not only related to the mathematics. However, he was mathematics philosopher, but he talks that this framework is applicable in solving all kind of a problem, and a people used to come across a lot of problem in their life. Okay, so he talks about that there is a four stages of solving a problem. The first, you have to identify and understand the problem. What are the condition, what are the parameter, what are the kind of a solution that is required, that you have to understand the problem. Then the next thing is that devise a strategy, means within that, how, what kind of a strategy we will have to solve the problem. And then using the device, means whatever the device you have conceptualized. And the last one is the reflective strategy, that looking back. So whatever you have thought, whatever you have planned, whatever you have plan you have carried out, so to which extent it has worked, so that when you will face the same or a similar kind of a problem, you will have some working solution in your hand. So I think the detailed discussion about all those things we will have in the next class, because from 10 o'clock I have to take a class of a B.Ed also. So we will stop up to here, okay. And the question answer session and all the discussion, even the problem solving and mathematics science, we will have a detailed discussion in the next class, okay.
Okay, sir.
So we can stop the class here. Thank you for being with me. Have a nice day.